And I think everyone is here now. Everyone's let in. Okay. So we're gonna get started. Hi, everyone. Welcome to Rest Days and thank you for being here. I'm Kyla Jamieson and I'm the organizer of Rest Days. To start off, I'm going to turn things over to Libby Osler, who is our virtual stage manager and tech support for today.
Hi, my name's Libby. I'm going to be the tech assistant for today. I am blonde with bangs, a messy bun, and wearing a red shirt with overalls. Things I want to tell you is that we have two ASL interpreters today, so we'll be spotlighting them alongside of each speaker. To help you see them, if you press, just make sure you're on the speaker view on the top right hand of your Zoom screen. We also have someone live captioning today, so if you press the CC button on the bottom panel of your Zoom panel, of your Zoom screen, you'll be able to see the captioning. If you don't want that, you're also able to hide any subtitles. Also, we are recording today, so if you do not want your visual to be recorded, please feel free to just keep your video off. One more thing is that we are allowing speakers to unmute themselves during the event, so please be mindful to keep your mute button off. And if you have any other questions for me about accessibility questions or any issues you may be having, please feel free to message me directly on the chat. Okay, over to you, Kyla.
Hi, this is Kyla again. Thanks, Libby. So I'll start by describing myself for anyone who can't see me or who is resting their eyes while tuning in, which is my preferred mode of attending Zoom events. I am, like all of our guests today, a very beautiful person. I am a mixed race Anglo-European and Japanese cis woman. I'm wearing my reading glasses and a denim shirt. I have long brown hair and I'm on my bed, which has white sheets that you may see later if I move to laying down. and is against a white wall. Above me is a large, colorful abstract painting. Before I dive in, I just want to share that my intention is that this space be a gentle one for all of us. I would like to encourage all of you to do whatever you can to make yourselves comfortable. We will be taking a 10-minute break halfway through, but please feel free to take additional breaks and put yourself first. So I'm trying to speak more slowly because of the interpretation, if you're wondering. I'm going to talk about rest days and share a land acknowledgement, but right now, if there's anything that any of you need to do to take care of yourselves, or at any point during this event, please do. You're not missing anything that you can't watch later, and I want this to be a space where nothing is more important than tending to yourself. So, rest days. Rest days is a bit of an experiment. My first collection of poems came out last year and my Twitter bio was like, too tired for a book tour. I find readings really exhausting, and I wanted to experiment with the reading series format. So what we've done for rest days is all the poets you'll meet today and have the pleasure of meeting have recorded themselves doing their reading. And those readings are captioned and they're available as of today on YouTube as a playlist. Today we have, I think, 7 or 8 of our 9 poets with us. And each of them is going to introduce themselves in their own words. I've asked them to share a quote by someone who's an important part of their creative or disability or illness lineage. And I really just selfishly wanted an opportunity to get us all together in one place. I'm really, really excited to hear from each of these poets and get to know them better through this gathering today. Eli Tarek Albashalame Lynch couldn't join us today, so please send them healing vibes and look for their reading on YouTube. Okay, so today I am broadcasting from the unceded traditional and ancestral territories of the Squamish, Musqueam, and Tsleil-Waututh Nations. If you're interested and unfamiliar with the land you are on, I'd recommend the site nativeland.ca. It will show you whose land you are on, and you can then learn more about each nation. I want to acknowledge and recognize the need to restore and shift power and influence back to these nations. I personally would feel much more hopeful about many of the challenges we're collectively facing if those in power truly honored the waters and the land as life-sustaining gifts, and if Indigenous wisdom was shaping the decisions that are being made. Indigenous leadership and power is part of the better future I am dreaming and that I hope we can dream and move towards together. So before I introduce our first poet, because today is a day of poet introductions, I would just like to share a short prayer or request that's very Nap Ministry, very Adrienne Marie Brown. May rest permeate our lives, connections, and communities. May dreaming reshape our world. And now it's my pleasure to introduce you to our first poet, Sho Yamagushiku. Sho, over to you.
Hello, everyone. Thank you so much, Kyla, for that slow. It's good. Sometimes I move too fast, so I really appreciate this pace. My name is Sho. I have an orange shirt and long hair that's pulled back, and have light skin and have a white background that's a ceiling behind me. Today I'm located on Wasanich and Lekwungen territories, and I think in thinking about rest, I think part of colonization has been a inability to stop and listen and think. And so I think rest is actually very much a part of what's needed to build better relations. So I'm grateful for this space. So today I wanted to share some words from Justin Chin. Justin Chin, I was born in Malaysia and raised in Singapore and came to the United States. And I realized that I think you know, Asian, the history of Asian immigration to this country and to these places has very much been about work and not, and becoming machines and being seen as machines that never stop working. And so there's something really freeing in hearing Justin Chin speak from a perspective about a body that has stopped working or that is not working in the way it's supposed to. So this is from Harmless Medicine, which is from his selected works. At one time, they told me that the voices in my head were the devil. At another time, China, and another, the medications. There are days when I think it might be the chemicals leaching out of my body. Or is it the soot of the city, the dust and particles from the construction behind my apartment? They're building new expensive modern lofts. I've left the windows open again. Or am I just dirty? So yeah, that poem's titled Harmless Medicine by Justin Chin. And, you know, I think that I chose it partly because he talks at the beginning about, you know, trying to find a cause for things. And I think I've sort of given up on that. I think that I see the pain and I see the things that move through my body, sort of like the weather. It's the world that's surrounding me. It's something that I learned to live with and lean into and befriend and understand how to hold instead of always trying to run from it. And in that way, sometimes it can become a teacher rather than something that is always there, but I'm trying to pretend like it's not. And so I think that in some ways, this sort of idea that something caused something is sort of a Western thinking, and actually everything is sort of coexisting at once. And so that's sort of what I wanted to offer and leave with everyone. So thank you so much for creating this space, Kyla, and I hope, I'm looking forward to hearing from everyone else. So thank you.
Thank you. That's so beautiful. I'm gonna cry today, guys. I feel like that relates also to Yamina, what she spoke to in the reading that she recorded. So I think it's absolutely perfect that she's introducing herself next. So I'll turn it over to Yamina.
Hi, everyone. My name's Jónína Kirton. I'm older, have gray hair, shoulder length, mixed race, Métis and Icelandic, so fairer skinned than many Indigenous people. There's a picture behind me. It's an amazing picture of by an Ojibwe artist called Robert Kegamakik. It's from 1980, and it has this beautiful woman who has her arm raised to the sun. She's touching the sun, and her breasts, which I have to move over for you to see, are feeding the waters. So it's a powerful, powerful piece. I'm in the land of the Kikite and also Stolo, Musqueam, Squamish, Tsleil-Waututh, people of the river. So a lot of Coast Salish use these lands. Oh, to think of slowing down. I have been a writer for several years now. So I have a couple of books and just finished a third, and I find the writing world exhausting. Things move too quickly for me. And so this is a really refreshing change. My quote that I chose, it's not from a, well, I don't know much about Virginia Woolf, and that might sound funny to you, but I tend to read other people than the old ones. So I read younger writers and lots of Indigenous writers and BIPOC writers. But the quote really hit me. It's, I am rooted, but I flow. And for me, that really spoke to what I have to do with this body, which has had pain many, many years now. And I need to remain in my body. So that's the I'm rooted part. That's not easy to do when you have pain. You want to escape. And then, but I flow is also another very important part, because I don't want to get stiff. I need to try to stay fluid. And I had a doctor who I consider a healer, who every time I'd leave his office, he would say, stay fluid. And every time he'd say that, my whole body would relax. So I'm really aware of how my body is listening to everything, to what I say, to what other people say, and how it responds. So when I write, I try to think of those things. I write about trauma, but I try not to harm others in the writing of that. But I think it's necessary to speak to it. And I also question how much trauma has to do with pain. As much healing as I've done doesn't seem to help. And we're often blamed. So, you know, people are like, well, why can't you get well? I'm a recovering New Ager for that reason, because people would be, well, you're just not spiritual enough, or you're just not trying hard enough. No recognition of systemic barriers, of all the things of what it's like to have a disability, to be disabled. And I'm not even sure about that word, so pardon me if I'm using an wrong word. It's new for me to speak to this. Anyway, thank you. I think I've spoken enough. I look forward to hearing from everyone else, and thank you.
Thank you, Jónína. Jónína shared, well, she led all of us before we opened the event in taking a deep breath. And I don't want that to be something that only we got. So actually, Jónína, I was wondering, do you want to lead us all in a breath before we continue?
Sure, I could do that. So maybe everyone who's with us, hope you're in a comfortable position and taking care of yourselves and your body. I love that Kayla was laying down there. That's just wonderful. If my desk, I'm at a desk, so I can't lay down. But just really take note of your body if you can, in a good way. Just kindly, gently pay attention to it. And then from the very core of yourself, let out a really, take a deep breath in and then let it out from the very core of yourself. And make noise if you want. Another one, you can do stuff with your lips. Sometimes our lips really want to get loosened up. And then once you've done that a few times, just really take note of how differently you might feel. For me, I feel a release all through here. You may feel more pain, and I hope that's not the case, but if it is, try to gently be with it. And let out one more breath just to try to let go of that as much as you can at the moment. And sharing silence is so powerful. Miigwech, all my relations.
Thank you, Jónína. Sharing silence is so powerful. I meditated with a friend the other day, and it was a really powerful experience. So we'll continue with our next introduction. Next in the lineup is Kayla Carter. Kayla, are you ready?
Hi, everyone. My name is Kayla Carter. I am a Black femme with darker brown skin. I have brown eyes and hair that is in medium twist right now that reaches about my ears. I'm wearing a white short sleeve top, pink acetate glasses, a gold necklace, gold hoop earrings, and I'm up against a cream colored background, and I'm sitting on a green couch. I'm currently existing and learning and unlearning on the territories of the Mississaugas of the Credit and the unceded Three Fires Confederacy. And the nations of the lands that I'm currently on right now are the Mississaugas of the Credit, the Anishinaabe, the Haudenosaunee, and the Huron-Wendat. I think for me, especially given the fact that the next question is about my work, for me being a child of Afro-Caribbean immigrants and being a descendant of Afro-Caribbeans, I think that it's extremely important that I'm constantly, hate the word interrogating, but really rethinking my connection, not only with this land, but with my understanding of what it means to exist, not only front-facing, but through my own decolonizing process of being in solidarity with the original caretakers of this land. And that means always interrogating what my positionality means on this land. So I think that's also a great way for me to open up about my practice. So I'm the author of a short book that's coming out soon, that's called For Fried Plantain. And it started off as a play, but now it's grown into something a lot more. My work and my writing really connects to my experience of not just being Black and femme, but what it means to be specifically Afro-Caribbean and the lineage and the history, specifically as it relates to colonial and imperial violence. And also just thinking about rest. Rest is something that I realize that I'm always having to convince myself that I'm worthy of. And I think for a lot of Black folks, so much of how we understand our place and the legitimacy of any power or sort of defiance we can share with the world when it comes to just being who we are, is so much geared around work and how much we can work. So yeah, that's something that I've been thinking about a lot lately. And then also I find that oftentimes when I share about being disabled and being specifically chronically ill, and being neurodivergent and being traumatized, oftentimes people sort of think it's the antithesis. So for me, it was really important to create For Fried Plantain, because it was also really important for me to speak about my lived experience, to tell the full truth, and not just the truth that would earn me Black excellence points. And then when it comes to the quote that I chose, a quote by a really brilliant, brilliant artist, Black queer artist who had to deal with cancer and experienced cancer. And her name is Jean Jordan. And the quote is, "Some of us did not die. I guess it was our fate to live. So what are we going to do about it?" This quote for me has guided a lot of my work, because of that work, of that quote, but also because of Jean Jordan's work, I've been able to like constantly substantiate the need to speak truth to power, regardless of what power it is. She does such an amazing job of like really getting me back into focus and saying that there is a purpose for you here, while also reminding me that the fate to live isn't about work. It's not about producing something. It's about like, what are you going to do with the life that you're living? And I think for a lot of us, folks who deal with being disabled and have been disabled by the world and deal with chronic illness and identify as MAD, I think in a lot of ways we're constantly having a very front-facing conversation with our life and what that means. But there's a grace whenever I think about Jean Jordan's poem. And I think the last thing that I would want to say, just thinking about how this quote relates to my work, but also rest days, I kept telling myself that my body doesn't need to earn rest, it requires it. So yeah, I guess that's something I would like to leave you all with today. Thank you.
Thank you, Kayla. Yeah, I think my hope is that we can all have an abundance of rest, even more rest than we require. So with that in mind, it's time for our intermission. So it's 2:31, and we're gonna take a 10-minute break. There will be a timer on the screen counting down. What I like to do is close my eyes and set a 9-minute timer so that I have a minute. Don't start it yet, Libby. So I still have a minute to transition back to this realm. Don't cut into my break. No, I'm not resting yet. we are all going to rest together. So I hope that each of you can find your rest. And we will meet back here at, now it looks like at 2:42. Enjoy your rest. And we're back. Welcome back out of the realm of rest. I was trying not to think while I was resting, but I was thinking about what Kayla was saying and how there are so many things that keep us from feeling like we can rest. And for different people, different things and different structures. But yeah, I think it's only recently that I started proactively resting before I became just completely incapacitated and my body and my mind forced me to rest, which was happening very regularly. So I think, like Sho said, that, you know, resting is like a very powerful, Ursula Le Guin might have called it, technology. And I'm really grateful to be able to rest with all of you. So shall we continue? We will be hearing now from four more poets. So we're gonna hear from Lauren Turner, and then Liz Bowen, then Owólabi Aboyade, and then Jimena Lucero. So Lauren, if you would like to introduce yourself.
Hi, of course. Thank you to Kyla for having me. I'm really happy to be here with such talented writers and sharing space. I'm a fast talker, so I'm going to try really hard to go slowly. I'm Lauren Turner. I am a cis white woman with shoulder length red hair and blue eyes. I am sitting on a gray couch. It's a white living room, and there's a painting of multicolored umbrellas behind me. Just a bit about me. I am a disabled writer who lives with chronic illness. My book, which came out last year, is called The Only Card in a Deck of Knives. And it's from All Second Wind. It came out like almost a year ago in August 2020. It deals with a diagnosis that I got when I was 26. I found out that I have a respiratory disease called Lyme, which causes benign cysts to grow in my lungs and my kidneys. These cysts can manifest in other organs, but this is just how it displays in my body. And ultimately, the prognosis for the illness is terminal. So it was very intense news to hear at such a young age. But recently, I feel like I wrote my diagnostic memoir, and I'm trying to move into more, I guess, like the realm of the living, because I was very preoccupied with that grief for such a long time. So the quote I want to read to you is by Max Fitfro, who has an amazing book called Four Reincarnations, which was released posthumously from Milkweed Editions in 2016. And the poem it's from is called Living It Up. I wish you would let me know how difficult it is to love me. Then I would know you love me beneath all that difficulty. I think for me recently, why that quote has such resonance is I'm writing and thinking a lot about what it means to connect with others, either like as friends or romantically, as a woman living with a terminal diagnosis, just because for me to connect authentically with people, it's much easier if there's validation that there is like unique difficulties in forming an emotional attachment with someone who might not be on the earth for as long as you'd want them to be or as long as they want to be, and just like the higher stakes of that. So it is something that I write and think a lot about. I know it's not exactly a happy topic, but it's just, for me, a lot of my writing, I do it for me, and also just like I hope that someone who's living also with difficult medical situation, like, can find something of themselves in my work, or just like a validation or just visibility. So yeah, that's why I picked the Max Fitfo. And yeah, thank you again for having me. It's really been very nice. Thanks.
Thank you, Lauren. Yeah, I've never felt so seen as watching the playlist of all of your readings that I got to put together on YouTube. So I think that will be, that mission will be accomplished and is often and in many ways accomplished. Our next poet that I have the pleasure of introducing is Liz Bowen. So Liz, take it away.
Hi, everybody. I'm Liz Bowen. I use she, her pronouns. I'm going to be reading to you for the next couple of minutes because speaking extemporaneously on Zoom is hard on my brain. And today we are resting. Let me know, though, if I'm cutting out because my connection's been a little unstable. So I am a white woman with straight brown hair past my shoulders and brown glasses. I'm wearing a black sleeveless shirt with gold and green earrings. Behind me is a white wall and ceiling that are kind of shrouded in shadow. I'm coming to you today from the ancestral homelands of the Mohican people. Though I live, work, rely, and rest on the traditional territory of the Wappinger and Munsee Lenape peoples. Today I'm thinking about what it means to rest on stolen land and how the need for rest among white settlers has been structurally supported by violence that denies rest to everyone else. So I'm thinking of this rest day as holding together both the necessity of rest for action and solidarity to be possible, along with the question of how to be responsible to rest as a matter of justice and redistribution. I'm the author of two poetry collections, and a lot of my work is drawn from my experience of chronic illness and disability over the past two decades, including type 1 diabetes, which means that I'm really moving through fatigue most of the time. So I'm very grateful for this space and for its pacing, where that doesn't have to be something that I'm hiding at the same time that I'm moving through it. I'd like to share a few lines from the poem On Closed Systems by Jillian Weissa. And this is from the book Cyborg Detective. Quote, I swore I wasn't going to teach you anything. When I started this poem, I want this poem to be for us cyborgs, because all the other poems from all the other centuries are for you, end quote. Jillian Weissa was the first person I was ever aware of who was committed to writing from the position of a cyborg. Not the metaphorical cyborg position of Donna Haraway and the techno-salvationists, but the position of a person whose body is quite literally part machine. Jillian, this author, uses the pronoun cy, that's C-Y, to signify the entwinement of disability and gender in shaping cyborg identity. Addressing a non-disabled reader, the poem's speaker expresses a worry that Sai is losing the reader because the reader may not understand the poem's references to prosthetic technology and disabled embodiment. And yet the speaker refuses to use the space of the poem to teach the reader anything, insisting on being in community with an audience of fellow cyborgs. Years ago, when I first heard Jillian speak about Sai's refusal to explain disability to non-disabled readers, my world shifted. As a person whose life depends on complex technology that almost no one in my life fully understands, I struggled for a long time to feel that I had permission to write about my body without providing a glossary. But when I found Jillian's work, I learned that disabled poets do not have a responsibility to accommodate the language of those whose language does not accommodate us. That accessibility to a non-disabled audience is not, should never be the mark of a good poem. And that conviction has been at the heart of my work ever since. That's it.
I was like, is she deaf? I don't know. Like, thank you. Thank you. Yes, to everything. Everything that you shared. We have next a video recorded by Owólabi, because he is here, but he's driving. So Libby, can you, yeah, thanks. Hi, Owólabi. Can you share your screen and show the video? Thank you. I'm not hearing the audio, so Libby, if you could pause.
You're not hearing the audio, Kyla?
Yeah, we're not hearing the audio, so I don't know if we want to just try again, or if anyone... Okay,
I'll try again. If anyone else is hearing the audio, let me know. Here we go.
Hello everyone. I am Owólabi Aboyade, aka Lucy. I'm a dark skinned African and
nephew. Pause and sorry everyone. Just pause and is there a way to turn the volume up? It's a little quiet.
Yeah, I have it, although I've just turned it all the way up. So I can the video does get louder as it goes along.
Okay, and everyone listening, you may also want to turn your volume up on your device.
Great.
Yeah, and how long is the video? It's like 2 minutes. So, 2 minutes, yeah. If the video audio quality makes it difficult for you to stay with us for these couple minutes, feel free to take a break. I'm seeing a message. I don't know, Libby, if you're also seeing this in the chat. May have missed checking the computer audio checkbox when sharing screen.
I'll double check. I believe I did, but why not check?
And while we're doing this, we are going to go, I think I'm estimating 5 minutes long today. I just wanted to give everyone a heads up about where we're at. I hear lots of clicking. How's it going?
Can you see the? Can you still see the video?
Yes.
Okay, I'm trying.
Hello everyone, I am Owólabi Aboyade, aka OC. I'm a dark-skinned African, a nappy short afro, with glasses on, sitting in a medical clinic setting. To your upper right is a bright light. It's shining. I reside in Wangatanong, aka Detroit, ancestral and ceremonial land of Anishinaabe, people of the Three Fires, Ojibwe, Odawa, Potawatomi, Here's my quote. When the reasoning mind is forced to confront the impossible again and again, it has no choice but to adapt. In K. Jamieson, the fifth season. And I'll add one more clue. Difficult takes a day, impossible a week. Jay-Z. As we'll see, I've released 2 albums and 2 mixtapes. I also write poems and essays. My latest hip-hop mixtape, the Mutation Mixtape, called for the mutants, the forces of nature, to announce our intentions to smash normality. The intersection of colonization, chronic illness, trauma, and ancestry brought about conditions that most normal folk would find impossible to bear. I pray and hope that my poetry, essays, and music not only shed lights on my mutations, but also provokes mutagenesis for the constant reader. Thank you. If you're watching this, I'm traveling in northern Mississippi in Anishinaabe territory, and I don't have the signal to be able to join directly. So thank you so much. Peace, peace.
Thank you. So Owólabi is here. He's in our audio sphere with us. He, like everyone else, has recorded his reading. So that's on our YouTube playlist. And thank you for recording that video so that you could be with us in our screens as well. And I'll introduce now our last poet for the day here, Jimena Lucero. If you'd like to speak to yourself, of yourself.
Yeah. Hello, everyone. I'm Jimena. I'm speaking to you from occupied Lenape and Canarsie territories. And the quote I chose is, if those committed to justice do not make their space accessible for people of color with disabilities, there's erasure in those movements. And the quote is by Kay Ulundi Barrett, who is a friend, a mentor. Although I feel like I could quote so much more from Kay. I actually have a post-it on my desk that just has a question that Kay once texted me that says, how are you being loving to yourself? And that's something I try to ask myself every day. My work is about living with a disability, living with chronic pain. My work is also about domestic violence and interpersonal violence, as well as systemic and political oppression. And yeah, that's pretty much what I write about. And I'm just really happy to have been a part of this. And I'm so inspired by today. So thank you all.
Thank you. And I mean, your work is also just like a salve. I feel like whenever I hear your work, I just feel like it's speaking to that really like deep calm, like the part of yourself that knows that like the status quo is completely effed up and like just knows that there's like another way of like living and viewing, like a whole other worldview. And it's such a gift. So thank you so much for being part of this. I'm so happy that all of you like responded to this invitation to be here. We will wrap it up now. I am very tired. I'm ready for another break. and I don't know if anyone can relate, but there are some thank yous that I want to share. So I feel like maybe some people might be wishing there was a Q&A portion to be a little bit more in dialogue with everyone. And that's something that I just wasn't able to fit into this hour that I planned. But if you would like, as guests, if you would like to follow the poets, comment on their reading videos that are on YouTube, and be in touch that way, I think we would be happy to be in touch. And I hope that the readings that are on YouTube from each of these poets, and also I forgot to mention Bara Hadik is another one of the poets who was going to be here today and who did a beautiful reading from bed that's part of our series. Yes, so I hope that the readings that everyone here today and who couldn't join us today have created will make you feel seen. And my deepest, deepest hope is that they might be gentle enough for you to let them into your rest days. I know my rest days tend to be very like, I'm not taking anything in, but I might let these videos in. to give me strength in my rest. I want to thank first and foremost the poets. All of the poets for rest days have done so much to make the readings as accessible as possible and just put so much work into the recordings, which I know are not easy to create. So I'm just really grateful to all of you. I'm looking at all your little faces on my screen. I'm so happy that we could all get together in this way. And I do feel like I must thank the League of Canadian Poets and the Fawn Parker Agency's Elaine Norman Memorial Fund for providing our reader honorariums, and the BC Arts Council for funding accessibility for rest days. And it is not lost on me that the funding that made this compensation possible is deeply rooted in a genocidal government structure. and I just want to acknowledge that stickiness at the very least. I also want to thank my mentor, Adele Barclay, who's our Zoom patron, as I mentioned earlier. I want to thank Libby for tech support, Debbie and Ev for the ASL interpretation, and yeah, all of you for being here. So to all our guests, I'm really grateful for all your support and the enthusiasm that people have for this space. Thank you to absolutely every one of you for being here. And I hope you all have a beautiful and restful rest of your day or night. Thank you.